Thank you, Aries. Thank you, City Harvest. Thank you for your great welcome. Appreciate your kindness. Come on, let's give Jesus the honor for what he's about to do. Hallelujah! We love you, Jesus. We honor you tonight. We open our hearts that you would move in power. Say, come, Holy Spirit. Fill us. Deliver us. Move in power. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Give someone a high five before you sit down. That's it. There you go. It's the last time you'll clap with those demons. Here we go. We're in for a great time. I've got two beautiful daughters with me here. I've got seven children altogether. Isn't that a few, eh? Four girls and three boys. And we've got 15 grandchildren and four on the way. We're planning to fill the earth. So we do. So here's my beautiful PA and daughter, Joanna, Joe, and it's my girl, Sarah. And they're really, very, very supportive. They love their dad, and it's great having them along because they can just sort of point up to the screen and say, hey, look at yourself on the screen, Dad. You know, where there was nice hair, there's now a solar panel. Hey, we're in for a great time. I'm so glad you came. And I want to just share very briefly from the Word of God. I want to just prepare an environment for us to minister and for God to move. Last night, God just touched, delivered hundreds and hundreds of people. I just really trust that you'll be open to let God touch your life. You may have come just to spectate. You know, hey, good. That's good. But if you find yourself screaming, do come to the front. Because it's the real thing. It's where the power comes. It's where God touches you. So during the time we have in the meeting, I never know quite how God will do it. And so I just have something prepared and then we just start to flow. And since we have a limited time, because there's another service coming in, I'll just preach quite short and then we can get into ministry and make plenty of time for a couple of altar calls and for anyone wanting prayer to get set free. So we're going to talk a little bit about deliverance. I want to share a bit about it. If you find during the meeting that you start to get agitated, then that just means a demon is just getting upset and it's wanting you to leave and take you with it, but you're going to stay and get delivered at the end. Why don't we just open our Bible, Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, we're going to look at an example of Jesus delivering someone. Luke chapter 4. I just love this passage. And in verse 33, now in the synagogue there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon. And he cried out with a loud voice saying, leave us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come here to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked him saying, be quiet, come out of him. When the demon had thrown him down on the ground, came out of him and didn't hurt him. Everyone was amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, what a word is this? With authority and power, he commands the unclean spirits, and they come out. Major part of Jesus' ministry was deliverance. Deliverance involves breaking demonic bondages, casting evil spirits out. The Bible says in Acts 10:38, Jesus was anointed with the Holy Ghost and with power, and he went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. There is a very real spirit world around us. Within that spirit world, there are demonic spirits and they're in a hierarchy of rankings. They seek to find a way or a doorway into people's lives. Demons can occupy houses, they can occupy objects, but most of all, they want to get inside a person. And they want to get inside a person in order to frustrate God's design for your life, to frustrate God's destiny for your life. Secondly, they want to get inside a person so they can reveal and manifest their nature through you, using your body as their method of expression. And thirdly, they want to keep you completely in bondage until eventually your life is destroyed. And so this is a reality that Jesus came to manifest, to show, and to expose. In 1 John 3 verse 8, I think it is, it says, he said he came to destroy the works of the devil. So in this particular story here, we see a man in a church environment who needs deliverance. He has a problem that cannot be solved by just discipline. The problem cannot be solved by medication. The problem cannot be solved except a superior spiritual power is exercised. So Jesus came, anointed with the Holy Ghost and power, to set or heal people who are oppressed of the devil. That word oppressed in Acts 10:38 means to exercise spiritual power and hold someone down. So this man in the story here is a very real person whose life was tormented by the presence of an evil spirit. Evil spirits don't announce that they're coming into your life, not usually. The Bible tells us the kingdom of God is a kingdom of light, and so everything God does is in the light in the open. So when you become a Christian, you invite Jesus Christ to come into your life. You know who you're responding to. You're asking for God to come. You know it's Jesus Christ that you're talking to, and you know it's the Spirit of God comes into your life. You know what's happening. It's in the light. Kingdom of the devil is a kingdom of darkness, so you don't know what you're getting into. As you reach into that kingdom, you get involved with evil spirits, but you don't see or know what they are. They're in the dark, so you have fear in your life related to them. People in various cultures of the world know there's a spirit world, so they try to engage it in some way, usually through forms of idolatry. Any attempt to reach into the spirit world without knowing that Jesus is the only way always leads you to demonic spirits. So Jesus came to set this person free. So let's have a little talk about this man and then see if we can identify what happened. It says, now in the synagogue, the man who had an unclean demon cried with a loud voice saying, leave us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come here to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. So he had a demon. A demon is a spirit. It's a spirit being. You are a spirit being. You live inside a body. You have a soul. So you have mind, will, and emotions. You can think and feel and make decisions and direct the course of your life. An evil spirit is a spirit being, but it's evil in its nature. The name of the demon usually describes what it does. Spirit of rejection fills people with their minds and thoughts with feelings of being unwanted. When a spirit of rejection operates in your life, you will continually feel unlovable, unacceptable. You'll be focused on the things that are wrong in your life, and it seems like you've got no ability to break free. Even though you hear what God says, you can't seem to respond. So when an evil spirit enters a person, it begins to try to increase the bondage in their life. And also evil spirits seek to bring others in. You notice this man, the demon said, leave us alone. So there was more than one. So what is it like if you're tormented with demons? Well, there's many ways that you might experience this. In a meeting like this, for example, when the anointing begins to flow, evil spirits become agitated. So it's not uncommon when I have deliverance meetings for someone to just manifest something will happen. In fact, I was in the middle of one meeting just talking about it, and as I began to talk about it, someone just began to scream out. It just right on cue, like I'd orchestrated it, but it was the demon just crying out. And I was in here one last year, and someone just came out and he just started talking. A lady walked out and held a broom up. She wasn't even in the meeting. She was actually outside the meeting. She was a cleaner. And she came in and shook a broom. Why you come here? Why you do this to me? And I just started talking, you know. And so she needed deliverance. So if you're in a meeting today and demons start to manifest, the first thing you may feel if it's something happening in you is fear, worry. You may feel agitated inside. You may feel like you want to run away. I've got to get out of here. Yeah, but you're trying to be nice and cool and not show, but you're feeling that inside. That's a spirit, okay? It's not you. It's a demon who is afraid because demons recognize the authority that a man of God carries when they come in Jesus' name. Or you may find that you feel like a tightness come around your head. You may feel like you can't hear. I've even had people, and the moment I stood up to speak, they just went, whoa. The moment I finished, wait, just like that. Now, it just couldn't happen like that. It was a spirit. And or you may start to find you get very angry. And sometimes when demons get stirred up, they get very, very angry, and they just think, that preacher, I want to kill that preacher. And so I've had a few people run around and try and do things, but as you can see, I'm still here. Yeah.
Jesus said, I give you authority over serpents and scorpions and all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall in any wise harm you. See? So we don't have to be worried about being harmed.
So you notice now as we look at this meeting here, this man was tormented and he had a particular spirit, an unclean spirit, which some of you here have. Tell the person next to you, it's not me, it must be you he's talking about. Well, I know that. We had hundreds here last night. It was amazing. So we'll have an altar call for people to be set free of this. So here's what was happening in the man. The man was tormented in his mind. He had sexual thoughts would keep coming to him. He had images of previous sexual experiences or images he could not control. His mind was tormented by these things. He continually had a drive in his life he could not seem to get over. He was in bondage to the spirits. The spirits were using spiritual power to manipulate his life and express themselves through his thoughts, his emotions, his desires. And although he tried to discipline himself, he was continually falling into sexual sin, could not get free because behind it was an evil spirit. So this man was tormented in his personal life. Normally when you have an unclean spirit, you'll have with it a spirit of shame comes as well. So you have the temptation or the thoughts come followed by shame, feeling that I'm bad and God could never accept someone like me. And so people become tormented by it. I would have no doubt whatsoever that in the time of worship, some of you were attacked by unclean spirits and you had unclean pictures come into your mind. And then you feel ashamed that you have those thoughts. So these spirits work together. So this man was tormented by unclean spirits. Now, there's a whole number of ways people can be tormented. People can be tormented in their body with sickness. I had one young man here, and we prayed for him, and he had a spirit of infirmity, and he had back condition and pain, moving pains in his body. But the moment he was delivered, immediately the pains all left, and he was set free. So when the spirit is driven out of a person, then whatever held them in bondage, usually the thing that people say is, I feel much lighter. That's the most common thing. And that fits with scripture, which says the devil uses spiritual power to oppress or hold people down. So effectively, when you're in bondage to an evil spirit, one, you may not be aware of it. Two, you try hard, but you can't ever seem to get the breakthrough or victory in that area. And three, if you don't deal with it, it seems to get progressively worse and you can't seem to have any power to overcome it. And so this man came in there and in the presence of the anointing, the demon became enraged and began to scream out loud and manifest itself through the man. It began to cry out, leave us alone. Demons are terrified of Jesus Christ. They recognize who he is. They recognize the authority he carries. They are terrified of him. So here's this man, and he needs to be delivered. He needs to be set free of the spirit. How did the spirit get into his life? How do spirits enter people? And more importantly, has one entered you? Wow. Well, that's quick. You're in the right place to get set free. So you come to the right meeting, made a good choice. Okay then, so how do spirits get into people? There's a number of ways. Demons generally cannot access a person unless some opportunity is given to them. So they can't seem to get into a person's life unless they can deceive you into taking actions that give them room to come in. So demons operate by deception and they're opportunists. They look for any chance to gain access to a person's life. So let me give you a list of some of the ways that demons commonly gain access to a person's life. And as we go through the list, you may find that there's maybe one of these areas or two of these areas, and you realize my life is I've got a problem and I need help to get set free. And I encourage you in the altar call just to come up and present yourself. Be available to let God touch you and set you free. There'll be an anointing in the place to set you free. It's here already, and when we get to the time of altar call and prayer, demons will just suddenly start to come out of people. Okay then, so how do they get in? Well, there's a number of ways that demons get into people. And let me give you some common ones. One of the most common ones is they're in the family line. You know, you go to the doctor and he asks your family medical history. So we're interested in your family spiritual history. Genetically and spiritually, family lines are connected generation to generation. So once a spirit enters a family, it can go through the family, and then every generation afterwards, the spirits operate in those generations. Hence, it's important for you to shut the gate for demons so there's no affliction passes down to your children. So the Bible tells us that generational curses and iniquity can pass from one generation to another. It tells us that in Exodus 20, verses 1 to 6. So when your family, if your family has been involved in idolatry or your family's been involved with spiritism, calling up spirits, divination, magic, sorcery, any of those kinds of things, or sexual perversions, any of those kind of things, a door was opened into your family and the spirits then operate generation after generation after generation until they're stopped. Some parents dedicate their children to an idol or a temple. When they do that, they give legal ground to a demon to come in. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:27, give no legal ground or opportunity to the devil or any evil spirit. So number one, generational curses. How would you know if there was a generational curse operating? Because there would be a pattern of repeated failures or setbacks or issues happening in your family. Marriage breakdowns, violence, family breakdowns, unexplainable accidents, various kinds of things like that, or patterns of alcoholism, mental and emotional breakdowns. These things would run down your family line generation after generation with no apparent explanation. Number two, involvement in idolatry or the occult. Involvement in idolatry or the occult. Deuteronomy 18, verse 9 to 12, God forbids doing any kind of activity that engages evil spirits because it gives them a legal right to come into your life. So the occult. The occult means hidden, covered, secret. The occult refers to usually two kinds of activities: divination, seeking to find out your future, seeking information from the spirit world, supernatural information, or sorcery, seeking power from the spirit world. In recent years, there's a huge increase in the whole realm of the supernatural in movies, in all kinds of movies. People are just fascinated with the supernatural. X-Men, powers, you know, all this kind of stuff. And yes, there's been a whole series of, next one out's Green Lantern. So there's all magic ring and powers in the ring, you know. There's all the kind of, this has been going on for quite a while recently. And so there's an upsurge of interest in the supernatural. Harry Potter movies and various things like that. People are drawn into the realm of sorcery. And what you don't realize is that the power behind it is demonic. Some people I've prayed for last year at the Bible school, we prayed for to set free over 200 students who had been playing an online game. I think it was World of Warcraft, and they'd been involved in fantasy and involved in sorcery online for extended periods of time, and it opened their life to a demonic spirit to come in. Here they are, come to train how to serve God, but in their private life, through these activities in their imagination, are opening their lives up to evil spirits. Well, we got them to renounce the game and the evil spirit, the identity. The young man manifested publicly on this very stage. This is very real, this thing. And it's very seductive, because people are drawn into the supernatural very, very easily. So if you have been involved in any activities of the supernatural, having seances, calling up spirits to speak to you, if you've been involved in any kind of activity where there's been fortune telling or calling up some spirit or working with a medium or even casting spells or experimenting with spells, you know, spells to get power, love potions to try and get some guy to get interested in you, you know, all that kind of thing. But you enter the realm of sorcery when you do that. You know, there's that TV program Charmed out, and of course it's all about spells and powers and there's good witches and bad witches. No, they're all bad witches. All bad. No matter how nice they dress them up to look on the TV, the power behind it is bad. In the kingdom of God, you always know the power is the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of darkness, well, you don't know what the power is. Its source is concealed. Why is it concealed? If you ever encounter someone who is moving in any kind of supernatural power, always ask, what is the source of this power? And listen carefully for the answer. Because if it's occultic, they will carefully conceal what the true nature of it is. Fancy words, well, it's cosmic powers or, you know, whatever, or it's, you know, chi, you know, or something like that. Actually, what they're talking about is a demonic flow, demonic power source. Okay? So idolatry, when people bow down to idols, worship idols, they open their lives directly into engaging evil spirits. So generational curses, idolatry, and occult power. Another one is personal sin, habits of sin, sin habits. Sin habits. Sin habits that are unrepented of. Now, most of these habits that open the doorways to evil spirits are habits or they are reactions when people are hurt in relationships, when we have disappointments in life, when people hurt us. What's the most normal thing when someone hurts you? You get angry. You know, you get really angry. Now, if we don't resolve anger in relationships, very soon we can harbor injustice and unforgiveness. So typical doorways for demons are anger, unforgiveness. Jesus said in Matthew 18, 34, 35, unforgiveness opens a door for demons. Bitterness, where unforgiveness has been allowed to find root in your heart. Hatred. Hatred is not always expressed very strongly outwardly. It can be expressed as cold love, where there's a wall around your heart and it's just cold in your relationships. But the root is hatred. Rebellion, where people get so rejected and hurt, they consciously rebel, and that can be active, where they're constantly trying to push their will on someone else, or passive, where they're just resistant and procrastinate and just do things their own way. But at the end, the root of it is rebellion, and that opens the door for witchcraft to operate. So these are some doors through which spirits open, come in. So one, generational curses. Two, occult and idolatry. Three, unrepented patterns of sin, which come about usually as a result of being hurt in relationships. Four, sexual sin. Sexual sin's a major doorway for spirits to come in. Because when two people have a sexual relationship, they become joined, they become one, and and in that ungodly connection, evil spirits can come in and begin to afflict people. Not only that, when the relationship breaks up, there's usually a damage caused. People get hurt, wounded, rejected, they feel shame, and demons just exploit the pain to get into the person's life. So commonly, when people are having trouble, sexual struggles in their life, there's usually issues of rejection, and they're trying to feel good through the relationship. They're trying to draw their answers to their needs through their sexual sin. Pornography becomes a major area of bondage for people because what happens is there's an idolatry. You're looking to images, looking to fantasy and masturbation to meet a need for comfort in the heart. And what happens is you open your door of your life to be bonded to the images. So when people have been involved in pornography, whether it be male or female, the most common thing is to have bonds or connections locked in, and you can't seem to get rid of the images out of your mind, nor the draw back to it. It becomes quite addictive. And behind it are spirits of lust and perversion. These are major traps. In the area of sexual sin, of course, is sexual abuse, where someone forces upon you activities you don't want to be involved in, and that violates and wounds a person, and it opens the door for spirits of perversion, unclean spirits, to defile them. Often when a person's been involved in such things, they're so hurt, they react by building walls in their heart, wanting to die, death wishes, and demons use all of these as gateways to come into their life to torment them. So you find it's not uncommon when there's been a breakdown or sexual relationship and then the relationship breaks down, not uncommon for people to get depressed and suicidal. Demons torment them as a result of these things. And Jesus came to set us free from all of that. So, another area is the area of rejection, where people are deeply rejected in their life, rejected by their parents, by a mother, by a father, rejected by their family, rejected at school because they were different, maybe some physical feature or something in learning. People can be abused verbally at school. It's most common when people are deeply scolded. Scolding is not a biblical form of discipline. Scolding is a way of shaming people so that they will cooperate or they will come under control. And so when scolding takes place, often the words deeply wound the person, and there are usually spirits that are attached to that. So when we're rejected, There's a deep emotional pain with it, and demons use it as a doorway of entrance to cause you to believe in your heart that no one could ever love me, no one could accept me, and so you become tormented. And when you try and break free of it, you find you can't seem to get established easily in God because of these things around your life. Another doorway is abusive or controlling relationships where someone controls you with violence or fear or threats or manipulation. Inevitably, when a person is under a relationship which is controlling, they feel rejected and they feel resentful and angry and hostile inside, and it affects them. They, in the end, spirits come in and hold them in torment. Another doorway, a common doorway, is emotional trauma, having shocks or accidents or terribly frightening experiences. That is another open doorway for spirits to come in. And the last one I mentioned is just abortions. Abortions open the doorway for spirits of death and murder to come into the womb. And often people who have an abortion suffer immensely, emotionally or spiritually, or in their marriage, or with having the next child. I have known one particular woman I prayed for. She was having her fifth miscarriage. And I was quite saddened because we'd prayed for her to keep the child. And so we went to visit her and I said, Lord, what is going on here? And the Lord said, just ask her. And the Lord said to me this, all of the children were boys. Get her to ask her father to pray for her. And so I went around and we comforted the couple as best we could. And I asked the young woman who's having the miscarriage, I said, what do you think the child is? She said, I think it's a boy. I said, what do you think the other children were? And she said, I think they're all boys, actually. I said, how do you get on with your father? And she said, oh, I get on with my father fine. I'm his favorite. I said, really? And tell me about your family. So she said, we have the three girls, and I'm my dad's favorite. I'm the oldest, and the youngest sister's my mum's favorite, and the other one's sort of in the middle. And I said, is that so? And I said, well, then why don't you get your dad to pray for you? Oh, I won't do that. I said, really? As he's a Christian, why can't he pray for you? Oh, and then I said, do you notice how much you're reacting? I said, tell me how it really is with your dad. And she then shared that the mum and dad had a bad relationship. Dad confided in her things he shouldn't have. Mum confided in the other daughter things she shouldn't have. And the result was she felt controlled in her life by her father and actually hated him. I said to her this thing, have you ever made an inner vow when you were hurting, I'll never carry a male child? And she thought and she said, yes. And I said, well, a spirit has come in and has been destroying each of your children that were a male, just like you made a vow. So any of these kinds of things are doorways for spirits. So how can we get set free? Look what happens here. It says, Jesus rebuked the spirit saying, be quiet, come out. And when the demon had thrown him down, it came out and did not hurt him. So Jesus is willing to set people free. The same Jesus set them free is willing to set you free. But there is a part you play in it. I want you to listen carefully and I'll explain very simply what the part you play is, and then we're going to have an altar call to minister to people. The Bible tells us that when Jesus died on the cross, he took all the curses. He became a curse for us, Galatians 3:13 and 14, so we could be blessed. The Bible tells us in Colossians 2:14, where Jesus died on the cross, that he canceled the power of sin so that the hold of the devil could be broken. So Jesus has made room for every person to be saved and to be set free. Why is it people don't all get saved? Very simply, it requires you hear the word of God and believe. So even though God has made the provision, something is expected from you. So here's what's expected from you. Number one, we need to recognize and take full responsibility for our life and its condition. It's your life, not someone else's. They're your demons, not someone else's. So you must own your life. Stop blaming someone else. This is my life. This is how it is. I got issues. I've got troubles. I've got spirits troubling me. Number one, recognize the condition of your life and take full responsibility. Stop blaming. The person who blames is powerless to change. Number two, we need to repent of anything that we have done that has opened the door for a spirit to come in. We need to repent of it. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Number three, Jesus made it very clear that he will forgive us, our Father will forgive us as we forgive others. We need to release forgiveness to others. We want to be set free, we must release forgiveness to others. I was praying for a woman last night, and in the middle of it, she was screaming and yelling, and demon was calling out and speaking. And in the middle of it, this is what she said, I hate my father, I hate my mother. Well, there's a demon come into her life because of unresolved hatred. She needed to forgive and release, or the demon remained in there to torment her. So as you're preparing your heart now to come and pray, get prayer and get ministry, you need to forgive. You must let go. Fourth thing, we need to renounce if we've made any agreements with evil spirits. If you've invited a spirit into your life or made any inner vow or death wish or covenant with a demon of any kind, you need to renounce it. Renounce means to cancel it. I cancel my deal with you, devil. It's as simple as that. Yeah? I cancel it. Okay? I renounce it. I break the words in Jesus' name. Very simple. Then finally, we need to reach out in faith to Jesus Christ. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Jesus can and will deliver you if you reach out to him in faith. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved, delivered, set free. Set free in Jesus' name. So Jesus called the man to himself, rebuked the demon, and out it came. Just as simple as that. We're going to just get the musicians up right now, and I want to give an opportunity for people. I want you to think about your life right now. I gave a list of a whole number of doorways of spirits. Now, what I want to do is you want to start an altar call right now. I want to pray, first of all, for people who have come from a background where there's been idolatry, there's been divination or fortune-telling, been involvement with the occult, involvement with evil spirits in your family background, or you've been dedicated to an idol, dedicated to a temple, or you yourself have been involved with the occult, involved with any kind of magic, any kind of sorcery, any kind of divination, addicted to games like that, you've been involved in those kinds of things. Or you may not be aware of that, but you know I got spirits visit me at night. I have stuff comes to me in my dreams. I feel choked. I feel like someone's molesting me when I'm asleep. I feel as though things move in my room. I'm terrified. There's something going on around my life. If you have any of those kind of experiences, or if you have had a background of idolatry, a background of witchcraft or spiritism, or you've been involved in those things, quickly stand up. Just come to the front. We're going to lead you in a prayer in a moment. We're going to get set free. Are we ready? Come on, let's all stand up right now. Don't just stay there. If this is you, let's move quickly so we can immediately begin to pray and minister to people. Just come, 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 come. Just come right now. Then I'll have a second altar call. We'll be having an altar call for another area. So come, please come right now. And while we're doing that, let's flow into worship. Let's build an atmosphere for God to move. Hey, how you doing? Come on, that's right. Come now, come, come. Make our way to the front. Right to the front.
here. God is here to set you free. To me quickly now. Power of God is here to set people free. Demons are starting to manifest already. I want you just to listen to me. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I want you to pray this prayer. At the end of the prayer, reach out to Jesus to set you free. I will release the power of God to come. The team will come and all my ex-men will lay hands on you. Power of God will begin to flow. While we're praying for people, there may be people, demons scream and come out, and maybe all kinds of things happen. For those of you who are waiting, just pray, worship the Lord if you're waiting for ministry. If you're just part of the congregation or waiting for the next altar call, then you just pray in tongues. So let's all just flow in this prayer right now. In a moment, the power of God, it'll get very noisy in here in just a moment. So I want you to follow me right now. Okay, listen to this prayer. Father in heaven, I come to you in Jesus' name. I confess Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. I'm redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ from every curse, from every evil spirit, from the power of sin. I am redeemed. I belong to Jesus Christ. I renounce every generational curse. Every word curse. Every agreement my family has made with evil spirits. I renounce it now. I cancel its power. I forgive family members. Who open the door to spirits. I forgive them. I forgive those who've hurt me. I renounce now. Every way I've opened. My life to evil spirits. I cancel it now. Jesus, I ask you to forgive me. And to set me free. Satan, go from my life. Now in Jesus' name. All right, reach out to the Lord now. Begin to pray. I break generational curses, idolatry, spirits of witchcraft, spirits of death, spirits of bitterness, spirits of hatred.
Thank you. into this mountain, to move into the ocean with your authority. You're given to me, no matter what happens. Here I am standing on the hope of your word. Promise to me, speak into this mountain, to move into the ocean.
Thank you, Lord. We thank you for your presence here right now. Just lift our hands to the Lord. Just worship for a little. Just worship him. Draw his presence. Draw his presence. Draw his presence. Want to have another altar call right now? I want you to open up your life. God is here. The power of God is here. Setting people free. People are being set free from troubling spirits. People are being released. Lives are being changed. We just worship you, Lord. Come on, let's lift our hands for a moment. While we're doing that, I want to pray in the area of sexual sin. If you're tormented with sexual thoughts, you're tormented with sexual issues in your life, perhaps it's pornography, perhaps there's been some relationships, perhaps there may be an abuse in your life, or you have some situation of deep a rejection in your life, a broken relationship. You say, God, I want to forgive. I want to let this go. I want to be free of that tormenting uncleanness. I want to be free of that anger and bitterness in my heart. I want you to make your way up to the front. I want you to make your way to the front. There's no judgment.
There's no condemnation. The woman caught in adultery, Jesus did not condemn her. There is no condemnation to having a struggle. Let's just make our way to where God can set us free. People who are struggling, you have sexual sin or addictions, you have areas in your life of brokenness and grief and pain because of relationships that have happened. Why don't you just say, God, I'm coming forward. I'm coming forward to let you help me today. I'm coming forward. Let's just make our way, as many as we can, up to the front. Then make a second row. Stewards, if you can quickly help, make a second row. Okay, now let's begin to worship the Lord again. Sexual sin, abuse, people broken relationships. I want you just to lift your hands to the Lord now. We're going to just pray a simple prayer. After we've prayed that prayer, let's begin to really pray strongly in tongues. Let's rise in our spirit for a breakthrough atmosphere to come. Whatever you've done, I tell you this, Jesus carried your shame. He wants you to be free. When you come up and for someone to pray for you, it doesn't really matter who prays for you. Just come with expectation. God, the moment hands are laid on me, I am set free. That thing's going out of my life. I'm going to be immediately set free. Come with an attitude of expectation that draws the power of God. Are we ready now? I want you to follow me in this prayer. Father, I come to you in Jesus' name.
Father, I come to you in Jesus' name.
I confess Jesus Christ.
I confess Jesus Christ.
As my Savior and Lord.
As my Savior and Lord.
I'm redeemed by the blood of Jesus.
I'm redeemed by the blood
from every
Jesus.
Curse.
From every curse.
From every bondage.
From every bondage.
From every evil spirit.
From every evil spirit.
From the power of sin.
From the power of sin.
I am redeemed.
I am redeemed.
I belong to Jesus Christ.
I belong to Jesus Christ.
Lord, I turn from sins of the heart.
Lord, I turn from sins of the heart.
Anger and bitterness and unforgiveness.
Anger, bitterness and unforgiveness.
Hatred, unbelief.
Hatred and unbelief.
I turn away from those things.
I turn away from those things.
I turn away from false comforts.
I turn away from false
all sexual sin.
All sexual
I turn
sin.
Away from it now.
I turn away from it now.
I break the soul ties.
I break the soul ties.
To people and images. I break them now.
I break them now.
I release forgiveness.
I release forgiveness.
And I ask you, Lord, to set me free.
And I ask you, Lord, to set me free.
Satan, go from my life.
Satan, go from my
now,
life.
In Jesus' name.
Now in Jesus' name.
Okay, let's lift our voice in prayer. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I break sexual soul ties. I break inner vows. I break death wishes. I break ungodly bondages over your life. I command unclean spirits, spirits of pornography, spirits of perversion, spirits of rejection, spirits of death, spirits of suicide, tormenting spirits of hatred and bitterness. I command you to go in Jesus' name.
you will save us, such a cost. The soul of man, and we give you praise for the power of the cross. We're so
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for your anointing. Thank you, Lord. There's a great presence of God here. Wonderful Jesus, we love you. Just keep drawing this presence. There's many, many people being ministered to, some still waiting. Those who are waiting, if you move your way as much as you can to the front so we can find you. Thank you, Lord. Make your way to the front. Make your way to the front. Voices and begin to speak in tongues. Let's just begin to build a strong atmosphere against the demonic. Come on, let's begin to pray in tongues. Those who need prayer, make your way up to the front. Make your way forward to the front. That's right. Make your way forward over there. Thank you for your mighty power to deliver, Lord. Holy Ghost, come.
We welcome you, Holy Spirit, Spirit of truth, Spirit of purity.
Come, Holy Spirit, follow me now.
Thank you for your loving presence. Thank you for the miracles you've done. Thank you for lives that have been delivered. Thank you for hearts touched. Let's give the Lord a great clap for all he's done. So many lives set free. So many people touched by the presence and the power of Almighty God. How we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. We thank you, Lord, for what you've accomplished. Listen, just a couple more things before we finish. Hey, amen, hallelujah. Now, for some of you, there may be more deliverance takes place over the next few days. If you start to find it feels like something's manifesting, pray in tongues strongly. Commanded to go out and just cough. You get a massive self-deliverance. When you get to your cell group, share what God has done. Just bring to the light what God has been doing. As you share, it just seals the deliverance. Some of you, there may have been deep abuse, and now it's surfaced, and you've had some freedom. You may need to seek counsel to deal with the deeper issues that go with abuse. Some of you will go back to situations which are very painful. You need to make a decision. No matter what anyone does to me, I choose that I will overcome evil with good. When people curse me, I will bless them. When they try to use me, I will pray for them. I will choose to walk with God and not allow myself to be defiled any longer. I've broken free today. I'm moving on into my destiny. I want to thank you for being just a wonderful, wonderful church, wonderful group of people. I want to thank you for staying with us and praying and supporting people who have been praying. I want to thank the team who have been ministering. We had a great team just pour themselves out praying for people. I want to thank also the musicians and worship leaders. Done a great job. Keep such a great atmosphere here. Let's give them a clap, those who have been helping and serving in so many ways.
Praise the Lord. You guys blessed today. Why don't we give the Lord a big hand? Let's thank Him for all the deliverance, all the freedom that's taken place. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's still a few people being ministered to at the front, so we're just going to continue to minister to them. But the Dialect Church will be starting in about a half hour's time, so we need to clear this place and just end this service right now. But thank you so much for staying with us. Thank you so much for praying and building an atmosphere so that we can minister today. Before you're dismissed, why don't you slap high fives with your neighbor and say, thank you so much for working together with God. God bless you. Have a great week. Those that are ministering, just continue to minister here at the front. The rest can be dismissed. The service is officially over. God bless you.